Hey folks, this is Emily with American Resiliency. It's warming up outside, people are getting outdoors more, and it's time to increase our knowledge about a significant climate-related threat. Ticks. I did a video a while ago. Here, let's look for it. There it is, about hazards beyond climate, mosquitoes and infectious disease. So in that video, I talked about how the ranges of invasive mosquito species and their associated infectious diseases are likely to shift in the US alongside climate. Like, if you're a nurse in a rural health clinic in Minnesota, you might not know what was going on if people in your town started coming down with what used to be a tropical disease. Ticks, which I hate, also spread disease. And for many of these diseases, appropriately timely treatment is critical for patient outcomes. Ticks are already known to be moving into new territory. Communities are already experiencing new to them cases of tick-borne disease. So learning to recognize dangerous ticks and tick-borne diseases is an important way to protect your health and the health of other people in your community. Just like with the mosquito videos, because I'm not a medical doctor, this video has been fact-checked by AR community member Dr. J, who is awesome and a highly qualified physician. On a general health note, I checked in with Dr. J about current H5N1 flu news. She's maintaining an alert but not alarmed stance on H5N1 related to your health, to human health. We're continuing to see no signs of human-human spread, and people who are getting H5N1 are surviving better than many infectious disease experts would have anticipated. You might remember this virus tore through wild seal populations with a 90% plus kill rate, but it's been very low mortality in cows. And low mortality in humans so far, particularly in humans who are acquiring the virus through contact with cows, which is where we're getting a lot of spillover events. So I want you to know we're watching that, and that compared to the other crazy crap that's happening, Dr. J suggests H5N1 can stay on your back burner of terror for now. And if you want to stay up to date on these issues, she recommends two sources in particular. One of them is SIDRAP with the University of Minnesota. Conveniently, also putting out some tick news today related to red meat allergies. We're going to talk about that more later. But if you go to their website, sidrap.umn.edu, you can click on Get SIDRAP Updates, and they'll send you emails with important information about emerging disease threats. Other thing that Dr. J highly recommends is Brown School of Public Health's Pandemic Center. They have a weekly email. And I'm going to put the link to this page in the video description if you want to get their weekly update about pandemic news. This way, you can be getting information from the most highly qualified experts if you're a person who is interested in this intersection between climate and disease. All right, Dr. J, thank you very much. You're the best. Let's get into some tick information. She's fact-checked this completely. Let's learn about ticks, what species to know for emerging disease, where they are, where they're heading. What diseases do they carry where early treatment is critical? So there's a lot of species of ticks. We're going to focus on just two. Black-legged tick, which I remember because the adult females look kind of like a nasty toe, and they're small. You can see they're small even when they're engorged. They're smaller than the tip of your finger. And the lone star tick, also small. It's got this distinctive dot on it. Ticks already have a broad range. And if we want to talk about a tick distribution map, my favorite tick distribution map, I've used it on his website before. This is Dr. Chuck Noonan's website. He's a veterinarian in Connecticut. His website contains an unexpected treasure trove of immaculately curated tick information. This range map he uses, I think it's about the best current range map available. You can see the ticks are coast to coast and that we have overlapping populations of potentially disease-carrying ticks, including that black-legged tick, sometimes called deer tick, and the lone star tick. The areas on this map you're going to watch are this zone here on the West Coast, where we're starting to get deer ticks, black-legged ticks showing up, and this bruise-colored zone. This is where we're starting to see lone star tick habitat expand, is throughout this huge bruise-colored zone. Used to be that lone star ticks were confined more to the southeast, but as we're getting more winter warming, they're moving far up north. I anticipate we are going to see lone star ticks invade my precious home territory in the northern Midwest. Let's talk about the West Coast first, though, spotlighting Lyme disease. As of 2020, we have seen Lyme disease carrying tick populations establish themselves throughout the West Coast and going into Arizona and Utah. We are seeing increases in Lyme disease on the West Coast as tick habitat expands. When I was a graduate student 20 years ago, there was a lot of concern about Lyme disease expanding into the Northeast, and now that is very much an established problem. There's been a huge wave of tick migration already during my lifetime. Unfortunately, we are now seeing tick-borne disease as a coast-to-coast issue. So no matter where you are in the U.S., let's teach you how to identify Lyme disease, because many people on the West Coast, they don't have generational knowledge about Lyme. Lyme disease is the real bad boy in terms of tick-borne diseases, both in terms of prevalence and the potential for long-term neurological damage. One of the first things you're going to want to look for if you're considering a possibility of Lyme disease is this rash, this distinctive bullseye rash. It's worth knowing, too, it doesn't always show up. If you got someone in your life who loves the outdoors, maybe they're out hiking regularly, maybe they do a lot of yard work, and they've got a low-grade fever. They've been sick for a week with kind of weird non-specific symptoms like headache, maybe some gut trouble, muscle aches, just feeling bad. It's worth wondering if maybe they have a tick-borne illness. They have these general non-specific, less intense than like a high fever you might get from a virus. And these illnesses benefit from the right antibiotic treatment. The rash, though, it's distinctive, that bullseye rash, and it can be an important warning sign. The treatment timeline matters for Lyme disease. Maybe people know about the author Amy Tan. She's the author of the Joy Luck Club. Amy Tan has been such an important voice to raise awareness of the effects of Lyme disease and what it can do to you if it goes untreated. You can get significant damage to the heart and the brain with major cognitive and quality of life impacts. With Lyme disease spreading now on the West Coast, it's important to be aware and to take those sort of low-lying, I can probably work through this illness type symptoms seriously. Because if someone has those general symptoms for like a week or two, ruling out tick-borne illness can be done with pretty basic blood tests. The bacteria that causes Lyme disease hides inside our cells, so the infection can be very hard for the immune system to clear on its own. Antibiotic treatment is effective and can help prevent that long-term damage to your brain and your quality of life. Let's look at this rash one more time. It is very distinctive, this bullseye rash. And I think it's worth noting that all of the examples that we're seeing here pretty much are on light skin. But look, on this darker skinned image, we can see that instead of pink, the rash shows up looking dark. People with darker skin, even if they present with the classic rash shape, are sometimes dismissed because the rash appears darker than the surrounding skin, rather than pinker than the surrounding skin. So folks with dark skin, it's especially important to know these sort of general non-specific illness signs, know they can be connected to tick-borne disease, and advocate for treatment. Going back to the range map, there's their next big threat, the expanding range of the Lone Star tick. This tick requires a pretty warm climate. It used to be confined to a much smaller part of our country. As we expect winters in particular to continue to become milder, the Lone Star tick is going to keep heading further north and further west. We expect this tick to start showing up in the Northeast and the Northern Midwest in a big way as we approach 2C. Fortunately for us, this tick is pretty easy to identify with its distinctive white spot on its back in its adult form. One of the symptoms of infection from Lone Star ticks can also be a weird rash, though it's not as clear and distinctive as that bullseye rash of Lyme disease normally. And Lone Star ticks can carry ehrlichiosis, a bacterial infection that can be spread by tick bites that has a lot of the same generalized symptoms early on that I talked about before with Lyme disease. However, to many people, alpha-gal syndrome is the most potentially alarming result of an encounter with a Lone Star tick. So this tick has a particular molecule in its spit called alpha-gal. It's kind of sugar molecule. Most people, their body encounters this sugar molecule, alpha-gal, and it's no big deal. But some people, their immune system encounters alpha-gal sugar, and it makes their immune system freak out. They start producing antibodies against alpha-gal, which has this convenient, weird side effect of making them allergic to meat. People who develop alpha-gal syndrome after Lone Star tick bites, they can develop severe allergic reactions after consuming any type of meat from a mammal. So we're talking about beef, pork, and lamb. Severe allergic reaction, like carry an EpiPen level allergic reaction. Some people even become severely allergic to animal products like dairy and gelatin as they continue to have immune dysfunction related to alpha-gal syndrome. If you develop alpha-gal syndrome, there's no cure. You just have to stop eating animal products or you will continue developing worse allergic reactions. This is the kind of thing where people need to be cautious if they think that they are developing alpha-gal syndrome because they can develop fatal systemic anaphylactic allergic reactions to consuming animal products. The only thing that we can do to prevent that from happening, to prevent people from getting alpha-gal syndrome, is to prevent tick exposure. If you don't want that to happen to you, you want to protect yourself from being bitten by the Lone Star tick. Let's talk more about that, because now you know how to identify a couple of seriously concerning tick impacts on human health, and you should be aware. These are threats that are spreading to new areas. If you or someone in your community has a low-grade fever, headache, they're tired all the time, maybe they got a weird rash, they've been sick for a week or so and they're just not getting better, you might want to suspect a bacterial infection caused by ticks. The sooner a person gets the right antibiotics after catching a tick-borne illness, the better off they're going to be. Untreated Lyme disease can have major health consequences, including long-term cognitive damage and impact, especially if you're on the West Coast, where Lyme disease is still considered an emerging threat, not all the way into the cultural consciousness. It's good to be aware. But I'm sure you don't want to just be aware. You want to be not bitten by gross ticks. The most important thing to do to prevent tick bites is to reduce your skin exposure, especially when you're in grasslands. They like to hang out in a grasslands habitat. Light-colored clothing lets you see the ticks better. And if you get like a tiny bite, it's not as big a deal as if they stay attached to you. The length of time the tick is on you matters, which is why the visibility matters. Wearing long sleeves and pants, preferably and dorkily, your pants tucked into your socks is an easy way to keep yourself safe from tick bites without using bug spray. The right clothing keeps ticks off, no problem. But using a tick-repelling bug spray and getting regular anti-tick treatments for your pets, also super effective. No matter if you're using a chemical or a barrier method, checking yourself and your pets for ticks is important when you've been outdoors. Ticks like to get into like the seams of the body, like they might hide in your armpit or behind your ear or up by the hairline. And the longer they stay attached, the more likely it is that they'll infect you with any diseases they may be carrying. And it's worth noting there isn't any pain when they bite because they have a chemical anesthetic along with all of these other potential gross things in their spit. You're not going to feel it when a tick attaches. Folks, thanks for sticking with me through this itchy and gross topic because I think this does give us important information we can use. When we think about where it looks pretty stable in terms of overall climate, you can see these tick movements are a change that's likely to impact both our designated lifeboat regions and the promising areas of the West Coast. But as someone who has grown up in tick habitat and been active outdoors all my life, I want you to know this is not information I'm telling you to freak you out so much you never go outside again. The only time I ever got a tick feeding on me, it was because I was hiking in the Badlands and I thought I was out of tick range, so I didn't take my normal precautions. Well, ticks are gross. I'm telling you this information because their bites are very easy to prevent. Ticks are not especially smart, they're not especially strong, they're not going to hatch a clever plan to come get you. If you wear the right clothes, take precautions with your pets, and know the signs that you need to get checked out for treatment, compared to some of the threats we're facing, this one's a light lift. We can grow the knowledge we need to respond to change to protect ourselves and our communities from this emerging threat related to climate. Let's get ready. Folks, thanks for spending some time learning with me. As you could probably hear, I was dealing with the onset of a gross but not tick-related sinus infection at the time of filming. I am currently ghastly, but thanks to medical treatment, rapidly healing. I hope to return in a less nasally sounding form next week. Until then, please know how much I appreciate you all in the AR community. And if this is your first time joining us, you should know AR is a donor-supported nonprofit organization. If you'd like to support our work, please donate at our website, www.americanresiliency.org, or at the link on the About page of our YouTube channel. Thanks for responding to change with me. I'll talk with you again soon.